Welcome, everyone. I'm Shoaib Khagda, Editor-in-Chief of Globe Asia Magazine. Indonesia's host to the World Economic Forum 2015 here in Jakarta. We are broadcasting live from the Shangri-La Hotel in Jakarta at a Berita Satu media session in partnership with the World Economic Forum. Indonesia is the fourth largest country in the world, with a population of 250 million people. 60% of these Indonesians are under the age of 30. Indonesia also has one of the fastest growing economies in the world. Over the past decade or so, the economy has expanded by an average of 6.5% per annum. It has a fast rising middle class. Today, there are 45 million Indonesians who are aspiring to enter the middle class. And by the year 2030, that number would have doubled. It has a vibrant democracy. In October last year, Indonesians went to the polls to directly elect their president for the third time in history. These are exciting times for Indonesia. Indonesians today are expecting more and more from their government and from their organizations and leaders. But there are daunting challenges, from solving traffic gridlock to raising educational standards, from creating better paying jobs to delivering a higher standard of living. Today, Indonesians want and demand to have first class standards. Joining us today in our discussion, which is titled Aspirations for an Inspirational Indonesia, I am happy to have a very distinguished panel, which I will introduce now. On my immediate left is Pak Budi Gunadin Sadikin, Chief Executive Officer of Bank Mandiri, Indonesia's largest bank. Welcome, Pak, and thank you for joining us. Professor Kishore Mahbubani, Dean of the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy. Happy to have you here. Pak Marsudi Suhud Sahudi, General Secretary of Nahdlatul Ulama, Indonesia's largest Muslim-based organization with 85 million members. Selamat datang, Pak. Thank you. Mr. Hans-Paul Buchner, Chairman of the Boston Consulting Group. Last but not least, Amanda Putri Widarmono, Founder We The Teachers. Thank you all for being with us. Let us get directly into the source of the discussion, the heart of the discussion. Amanda, if I may start with you, you're the baby amongst us. You represent the future of Indonesia. And you, of course, running an organization which I think is very critical to the future of Indonesia, which is helping Indonesians to enter the teaching profession. Maybe from your perspective as a young Indonesian, what are your aspirations? And what is your organization doing to meet this aspiration of a better education?
I think the aspiration for all human beings in general is to be full, and to be full in many aspects. The first one, of course, is the stomach full, that we are not hungry, that we're not living in poverty. And then number two is that the brain is full, that we are fully equipped with skills and knowledge to tackle the challenges and the reality. And then number three, the wallet is full, that we are economically capable to sustain a decent, proper lifestyle. Now, with regards to We The Teachers, we are working in the education sector. And what is the hope in terms of education sector? I think right now the standards needs to be reshaped and honed really into something that is sharper. Now, there are two sides here. Number one is to understand where Indonesia is going and to see the needs that Indonesia has. And of course, to provide linear solutions through the education system, through the formal schooling system. But then we also cannot forget the roots of Indonesian values, because we live in a world where everything is so hyper-connected. We are flooded by information, and it's so easy to lose ourselves in just the many, many pieces of anecdotes that we face every day. And it is crucial to really emphasize and highlight the roots of values of why we are here as a nation.
So basically, it's, you know, balancing the old and the new, the past and the future. If I can move to Pak Budi, as the head of the country's largest bank, of course, you know, your bank is all is critical to meeting one aspiration of the Indonesian people, which is, you know, hopefully a better standard of living and providing access to financial, you know, to the financial system, because a large percentage of Indonesians still do not have access to credit, which I think hinders them. In your view, how critical is this, and what is your bank doing to create greater access to the credit markets?
You know, Indonesian bank has been here for 350 years when the Dutch is occupying Indonesia. And during 350 years, only 60 million Indonesians have bank accounts. So you can calculate easily if you want to fulfill 240 million Indonesians to have financial access, we will need another 1,050 years. Of course, then we shouldn't do that because there is another industry, example, the telecommunication industry. I remember I first having my mobile handphone in 1994. So in 20 years until last year, they successfully penetrated 200 million of Indonesians. So if we can piggybacking on that industry, telecommunication industry, I think we can accelerate the penetrations of Indonesian people. But talking about Indonesia, Indonesia is very unlucky because we have many financial crises since 1998. But the other hand, we also very, very lucky because we have the most bankers, we have the most regulators, we have the most finance ministers that still live and doing the same job and have real hands-on experience in handling crises compared to many other countries. And I remember the last major crisis in 1998 where people told me, Budi, you have nothing left on your right side of your balance sheet and you have nothing right on your left side of your balance sheet is happening. But I can tell you, Indonesia survived in 2002 mining crisis, 2005 mini crisis, and also major crisis in 2008. Because there is also one, you know, lucky things for any Indonesian that we should understand. During bad times, Indonesian make good policies. But of course, during good times, usually we make bad policies. But that's why we need always sometimes bad times in Indonesian history. But I'm very positive and optimistic about Indonesia. In the next 15 years, 50 million of Indonesians will enter middle class. For you that understand 50 million, it is larger than population of South Korea. Yeah. It's slightly below the population of Thailand. So can you imagine in the next 15 years, one Thailand demand will be there. 50 million, one Thailand population will need saving account, will need credit card, we need car loan and mortgages. So that is a good business for me as a banker. And again, the last thing why you should feel optimist and positive about Indonesia in the future, you see Pak Marsudi and me is the present of Indonesia. If you want to see the future of Indonesia, you see Amanda.
That's why she's here. Thank you. Hans, if I can just take up on that point on being open and remaining open to stay competitive. You know, you travel around the world, and I think you've just told me that you've just come back from Washington. What is the global perspective on Indonesia today? And from where you sit, you know, maybe if you can maybe tell us one or two key challenges that Indonesia needs to overcome.
Yeah. Well, first I would like to follow up on what Professor Kishore has said about opening up. And it's not just opening up to foreign players, to foreign investments, but I think really creating a level playing field within the country so that it's open to everybody who wants to engage, you know, small companies, you know, no new entrepreneurs and so forth, rather than keeping certain sectors, certain businesses to a few or a handful of businesses which are well entrenched. Because I think that is really so important. I think opening up has not just an international dimension, it has really a domestic dimension too, because then it really creates the opportunity for competing, and competition is, even though it's a bit, I would say, awkward for everybody individually, I think it's very good for society and for the economy at large. And I think we need to keep this into perspective when we talk about opening up, when we ask for more competition, that we're not always thinking about, oh my goodness, we have to protect ourselves against the foreigners. opening up has a very strong domestic dimension, I think. Now, going back to what you've emphasized before, I mean, there is, of course, a lot of expectations towards Indonesia, Southeast Asia in general. I think Southeast Asia is, together with China and India, one of the three fastest-growing regions in the world. That's why there is enormous dynamic, but also the expectations are enormous. Obviously, the ASEAN economic community raises even more expectations. And I think people do hope that all the countries, in particular Indonesia, will really push for that. Now, in order to make that true, in order to really make good use of the larger region, it's very important, and I think that goes back to what Amanda said at the beginning, of course, to develop talent. Yeah. I think this is the biggest opportunity and the biggest need, and really to invest in all levels of education, primary, secondary, tertiary, but also develop vocational training and making sure that people really can earn a living and really can create and shape their own destiny and that of their families. I think that's very important. The second, of course, everybody talks about infrastructure, a big challenge for Indonesia, not just for Indonesia, I think for Southeast Asia and, of course, for the rest of the world. Many countries are struggling to make that work. I think a lot has to be done. And again, I think the issue is not, is there a lack of understanding of the needs? Yeah, absolutely, I think everybody talks about it. But how can you make this work? How can you make use of the land? How can you, on the one hand, protect the rights of people, at the same time make sure that really progress is being happening, so that not every highway, every port, airport, what have you, is really getting stuck into years, maybe even decades of litigation in courts and so forth, which is happening, I think, outside China. That's a big issue almost everywhere. And I would say, I think the third challenge and opportunity is to make sure that there are strong institutions. Of course, it's again in education, but it's also government institutions in general, making sure that there is really the rule of law can prevail, that there is a level playing field, that people can really depend on government processes, on good processes. And I think we've seen already over the last few months with the new government quite a number of activities to make that work. But of course, a lot more needs to be done. I think in general, very good progress, a lot of expectations, and I'm very optimistic that things will move forward here in Indonesia and in Southeast Asia overall.
Thank you very much. I think you hit on a very good point, is trust in public institutions, which is very critical, I think, if Indonesia is going to move up. And if I can use that as a starting point for Pak Sahudi from NU, of course, NU is one of the oldest and most respected institutions in Indonesia. You have 85 million members spread across the country. Your founders fought in the battle for independence in Indonesia, so you have a rich history. But is NU today prepared for tomorrow?
Yes, of course. NU is the biggest organization, not only in Indonesia, but in the world. We have 5 million members. And we are, as Indonesian people, very, very lucky that we have an organization, not only NU organization. There is another organization like Muhammadiyah Al-Wasliyah, and another. You can imagine a Muslim country, 12.9% total population Muslim in the world are in Indonesia. In Indonesia, 12.9% total Muslim in the world in Indonesia. And now every day we can see in the television, like in the Middle East, they are Muslim in Middle East, but they have not an organization like Indonesia. Like in Libya, Iraq, Syria, Yemen, and another countries. Indonesia have a big organization that can make a balance when it happened a problem in the country. We have more minister than the party have, and you have more minister than the party have. And also, we have people representative more than the party have. We have governor, bupatis, and so on. That's why if any problem in this country, Indonesia, I just contact them. We can contact the members of NU who sit in Golkar Party. We can contact the members of NU in the Democrat, in the any other party. And then we can sit together in the office of Nahdlatul Ulama. And then we ask them, what is the problem? What do you want to be? What do you want to make Indonesia to the future? That's why Nahdlatul Ulama guarantee that Indonesia will be in peace and peace, growing and growing, inshallah. Like most of the people, Muslim people in Indonesia, they ask to the government, they should give the policy like the values of their religion. The values of Muslim religion is tasarruful imam ala ra'yah manutun bil maslaha. The public policy from the government must be, or in the orientation must be for the people better and better. It must be. How to get there? To get there, between the government and the people must be in connectivity. Connectivity between the people and the government. If the people need, for example, like in NTB or NTT, because the harbor over there is not enough. So when we want a cow, maybe just it will be cheapest if we take from the Australia, because in NTT Island or NTB, the harbor is not as big as enough. That's why that the government should give the policy tasarruful imam ala ra'yah manutun bi al-maslahah. This is Islamic teaching. Connectivity between the program with the people need. Connectivity between the program that the government want to make it the program should be connected with the island, one island and another island. Because Indonesia have 17 million island, Indonesia, and the total land in Indonesia, the area of Indonesia is 5,193,250 kilometers. This is the Indonesia, and then the population 250 million, and now. Indonesian people, of course, feeling increase and increase, economic better and better, and inshallah, Indonesia will be the 7 biggest countries in the world because we live together among others. Not only just Muslim as a majority, Nahdlatul Ulama. Also, we have another religion like a Protestant is 6.9% and Catholic 2.6% and another religion, Hindus, Buddhists. But we are able to live together. We are able, if we have a problem, we can discuss one religion with other religion. We can sit together. This is maybe that another Muslim country cannot do like Indonesian countries. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think you touch on an important point, which is religious tolerance in Indonesia. Of course, you know, I think the broad spectrum of Indonesian society and everyday Indonesians would respect other religions, but there are minorities within Indonesia who don't. And at times, those minorities unfortunately give Indonesia a bad reputation, let alone, you know, destroy property and take innocent lives. Terrorism, of course, is militant Islam is a problem across the world, and I think is an issue which not just Indonesia, but many other countries are also grappling with in the region. Maybe on that point, but if I can come to Professor Kishore, how big is this threat?
You always come to me with difficult questions. Okay. Well, first, I will answer your question. But let me, reinforce a very key message that Pastor Hudi has made about Indonesia's culture of tolerance and openness. I mean, it's displayed every day. I mean, the fact is, if you look at Jakarta, which is the capital of the world's, most populous Islamic country in the world, about 20 years ago, when you came to Jakarta, you couldn't see any Chinese writing on the wall. It was not allowed. But today, you have a Chinese governor of Jakarta. That's an amazing transition that the world hasn't noticed. Yesterday, when I was driving around Jakarta, and I saw this wonderful statue, the Kuda Ramayana, the horses leading from a scene from Ramayana. And this is, again, the world's largest, most populous Islamic country. You have this incredibly large statue in Ramayana, which I don't see in India, by the way. So that's an example of the openness and tolerance of Indonesian society. Yeah. And frankly, I actually think that Indonesia's historic mission in the next few decades is to be actually a role model for the rest of the Islamic world on how to be so open and tolerant in dealing with other cultures and civilizations. I say this because I think on the one hand, let's take the ISIL threat. Mm. It is dangerous, but it is still a small cancerous tumor. And that small cancerous tumor can be excised. It can be done. But what is worrying about ISIL is that if it just came from one or two countries, it would be a relatively small problem. But it's what's amazing is that you have young people educated in the United Kingdom speaking better English than I do, coming forth and running and joining this organization. You have Australians, you have Indonesians, you have Malaysians, and it's amazing. So the question, therefore, which you have to ask is what are the deeper roots of this anger that drive these people to sacrifice their lives? And that one, I think, is an issue that the world hasn't handled well yet. So while we need to speak about the values of tolerance and openness and diversity, we also have to acknowledge that there are lots of young, angry people out there, and we have to try and address that challenge. And I think it's not going to be solved in the next 1 or 2 years. It will take for at least 5 to 10 years.
If I may just chime in, I think it's not just an issue of religious extremism. I think it's extremism from the right, from the left, and we have this in different shapes and forms around the world. Now, of course, it manifests itself at the moment, particularly in the Middle East. But I think, going back to also what Professor Kishore said, I think the issue of extremism is usually people who have been marginalized in their societies, way or the other. Or at least they feel, they perceive to be marginalized. Maybe objectively, it may not be that case, but they perceive to be marginalized. It could be because of lack of education, lack of economic opportunity, participation in society. And I think that is really the issue. And that's why we have all over Europe, we have young people, young men, and some women also joining ISIS in Syria, in Iraq, also from Germany, from France, and so forth. And I think that will be the key issue for us to make sure that people really participate. Going back to what you said earlier about inclusiveness has to do also with the opportunity to participate, and that means an open society that does not disenfranchise certain groups or does not prevent certain groups from participating. And I think, again, going back to the initial idea about openness, I think it is a much wider concept that has not just economic consequence, but also, I think, consequences in terms of how do people live together.
Absolutely. Amanda, You know, do you feel that Indonesia is growing increasingly open, an open society where people can share their views and, you know, participate, I think, in public life, be it politics, be it economics, be it religious, mm-hmm. That is not dominated by the elite, so to speak. You know, do you get that sense?
Certainly. I think technology has really democratized people's opinions, so everybody has a platform online to voice out their ideas and to be really vocal about what they think. Now, with technology, you can talk and you can communicate and interact with each other, and it is also very easy to react instantly, to reply instantly, respond instantly, and that's part of the double-edged sword of technology. But this extremism, we could actually leverage this to really voice out positive messages. For instance, taking the example of the last presidential election, Indonesia was very polarized because you only had two candidates, and it was either or, and everybody became so vocal and so fluent in politics, including the young people, in the short span period of time. So if we could use that extremism towards good causes, I think that could bring real tangible benefits to Indonesia, but that takes real commitment as well from the public institutions to build connections, to build relationships, and to really help in shaping the mindset that we are an optimistic nation by nature, and also from other sectors as well to help support this positive movement, because we're very fluid and technology has helped us to really just connect with each other.
Right. I'm just going to ask one more question before I throw the session open to the audience. Please identify yourself. You can make a comment, or you can ask a question, or provide. You know, we don't want to monopolize the discussion just up here. You know, we want everyone to join in. But there was one question that I wanted to direct to Pak Budi first, and that really is, you know, in line with what she says, is about helping people to get better paying jobs. And that, of course, we don't have a government minister on the panel. I wish we did, but I'm going to throw that question to you.
So he's going to become a minister.
He's leading that way. No. But do you think, you know, all, you know, for many, many years, of course, you know, Indonesia has been a top-down type society, top-down type economy. But now you see a groundswell of a bottom-up push where people are demanding change and not waiting for the government and doing things on their own. I know this is going to be a bit controversial, but do you think that going forward, is the government going to stay as relevant to the direction that this country is going to take as it is today?
The first time I entered a workforce, I remember in 1988, out of the 100% of total GDP of Indonesia, 60% was contributed by the central government during Suharto era. If you look back today, $1 trillion in terms of GDP, if you compare government budget, is less than 20%. So for me, it's very, very clear that the Indonesian economy, at least, was driven by the private sector more than the government. And I'm very bullish. I'm very bullish on it. If you see all the poverty index, the unemployment index, it went down. It doesn't mean that there are nothing that we can do better. There are a lot of things that we can do better. And I'm very, very optimistic because changes are happen. Not many people and press take a view of the positive angle of it. Most of it take the negative angle of it. Like example, I just mentioned to you, the extremism, mm-hmm. the separatism. I think at the end of the day, it came down to anger, like what you said. In Indonesia, maybe we are not the richest country in the world. We are not the highest GDP per capita. But I remember there is some research talking about the happiness index. Mm. Indonesia is the most happiest country in the world. Although we are very, very poor, but we are very happy. So it's very difficult for you to find extremism.
Singapore is rich and unhappy.
Yes, I didn't say that. I didn't say that, but then I can follow up on that one. You know, the Gini coefficient of Indonesia is 0.41.
Yeah.
Many people understand about it, but not many people understand the Gini coefficient in Singapore is actually higher than Indonesia. Mm-hmm. It's higher than Indonesia. So the tensions there are bigger. And I just give you another example. United States is the most democratic country, many people say. You never see the woman president in United States.
Yeah.
You see, so you saw an Indonesian woman president. Mm. And you see, sitting in this room, all dominated by men.
Yeah.
Only Indonesians have a woman representative.
Thank you very much. I think the direction definitely is very positive. Are there any questions, comments, you know, observations? Yes, but yes, sir. Please identify yourself.
Yes. Yeah. My name is Sahala Gaul. I'm a special staff for the state-owned enterprise minister, Mr. Rini Suwandi, Sumarno. I would like to make a comment about the openness of Indonesia. Mm. I think this is very important. We understand our economy actually is, I think, the most open economy in the world right now. Mm. We already have an agreement with so many countries, even China, ASEAN, and also China, Indonesia, and the other also, with the US also, the same thing with the other countries. But let me explain about the Indonesian right now. We also try to open all of the Indonesia region to the economy. That's why it's very important to make the connectivity in Indonesia economy. Our state-owned enterprise, we like to be an agent of economics, agent development for this country. We like to build up the port surround of Indonesia, especially in eastern part. Now we start to building up that one from Sorong and then 35 port in the eastern part of Indonesia. Beside that, I think it's our telecommunication company. Now it's already finished building up also the network in all of the Indonesia. And also we provide also infrastructure because we believe infrastructure is different. We have to supply infrastructure, and then the demand will come. That's the idea. So we will open the potential economic region to the world and also to the economy of Indonesia. Electricity, we provide now for this all of the Indonesia. In this year, 5 years to come, we will build up 35,000 megawatt electricity in all of the Indonesia. Now we do have already 50,000 megawatt ready for the economy. Also, we will build up also toll road, we'll build up industrial park in many, many Indonesia. In all of the island of Indonesia, potential state-owned enterprise will build industrial park. That's why I think it's, Indonesia is ready to grow and then also to face the challenge for the future. We will provide the openness of potential region Indonesia, and also to the company. We invite the private to participate. It's not just Indonesian local company, but also international. And state-owned enterprise will happy to join with all of them. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
And Mandiri is state-owned enterprise, by the way.
Can we have a mic? On this side.
Sato. Hi, my name is Satohiro Akimoto with Mitsubishi Corporation. I have a question to Professor Mabani. Good to see you again. My question is with regard to Indonesia's role in ASEAN. Assuming that ASEAN needs leadership among different countries, obviously, ASEAN is a looser coalition of countries as compared to a group of countries like the EU. But do you think Indonesia is playing a role, leadership role in ASEAN, as comparable to all the nice quality that Indonesia has inside, as well as weight of economy, weight of democracy that it has in the region. Thank you.
Well, I seem to get all the difficult questions. Well, I mean, let me begin by emphasizing one fact. My next book is going to be on ASEAN, and I'm going to say the title of my book is that it's Southeast Asia, the most blessed corner of the earth. And actually, it's amazing what ASEAN has accomplished in delivering peace and prosperity to the Balkans of Asia. And people have no idea how much worse off this region could have been if ASEAN had not succeeded, you know. So we have accomplished a lot. But I think that at the same time, to be very candid, 2015 is a very critical year for ASEAN. Because, as you know, this is the year when we are supposed to launch, among other things, the ASEAN Economic Community. And I can tell you the whole world is watching very carefully how ASEAN will do in this area. Now, I was a former diplomat. I was a diplomat for 33 years. And I can guarantee you that the ministers at the end of the year will stand up and declare victory and say, yes, we have established an ASEAN economic community. 85% of the products are now tariff-free, et cetera, et cetera. But, you know, it's not what you say that's important. It's what the markets believe that's important. So what I agree with you that Indonesia is, it is a very open economy. But at the same time, when I talk to several Indonesian businessmen, businesswomen, I get the feeling that there is a sort of growing trend towards economic nationalism in Indonesia. It hasn't surfaced yet in terms of policies, but it is a real sentiment that is growing in this country. And if that sentiment enters policy making into Indonesia, then Indonesia might provide the brakes on the AEC, which would be very bad for ASEAN, and so, by the way, also very bad for Indonesia. And so my advice to all the ASEAN countries, not just Indonesia, all the ASEAN countries, is fortunately, when you talk of openness and transparency and so on and so forth, there are now hundreds of indexes around the world. The World Economic Forum produces wonderful index on competitiveness. Now, if the ASEAN countries want to tell the rest of the world, hey, we are open and competitive, please declare your number on the World Economic Forum Competitiveness Index, because that's objectively done. And if you don't move your country up that index after you declare the ASEAN Economic Community, then you have to ask yourself, was that good enough a job? And that's why I think the next 6 months, by the way, are very critical 6 months for ASEAN. And I hope that, as in the past, the leadership will emerge. And traditionally, I mean, let's be honest about this. Indonesia is the largest country within ASEAN. Indonesian leadership is very critical for the success of ASEAN. So if Indonesia can come forth and push for a stronger ASEAN economic community, then it'll be an amazing result.
But it's not just this year. I think it's the next 5, 10, 15 years. I think the community will be built over many years. I think we should not just focus too much on this one year. Honestly.
But let me continue, because I strongly believe the Asian economic community so far has been a discussions at the political, government, or business elite. We should continue not to only discuss this at the elite level, but we have to bring this down to the grassroots, to the people level. So far what I noticed, it is discussions at the brain level that people talk about this intellectually, like the professor, you know, the political elite. But we are not bring this to the heart and talking about this passionately. And I think one major component that many people forget, and our founding fathers of ASEAN put it clearly in ASEAN Economic Community Principle, which is I totally agree, but we spend less time to discuss about this. ASEAN Economic Community is talking about single market and production base. Everybody is talking about this. Talking about global competitiveness, everybody is talking about this. But there is one item that people almost forget. Equitable economic development. And less people in ASEAN talking about this. Because I just put you some figures from Thomas Piketty. Back in 1820, the gap between the rich and poor is 3-1. In 1950, the gap of rich and poor is 35-1. In 2014, the gap rich and poor is 80-1. And history scientifically proven, you can only reduce it either with revolutions, French Revolution, Russian Revolution, or World War, World War I, World War II. I think we have to put a clear intention that the rich country like Singapore and Malaysia wholeheartedly, passionately try to bring Indonesia and Vietnam or other country closer to them. If the focus is to make us bigger, that will create unsustainability. That will happen in Europe because the rich country will come richer, the poor country stay poor, and it will not create sustainability. I am a strong believer if you want to create ASEAN as a move forward, a very solid economic group, then focus on equitable economic development as one of the pillars that our founding fathers in ASEAN assigned is something that we have to focus on.
If I may just jump in, I think the one issue that we haven't really touched on is bureaucracy, both within ASEAN as a as a region and Indonesia. You know, of course, Indonesia is famously very bureaucratic in many instances. As we open up and as we allow more and more Indonesians to participate in public life, how is that going? How does the bureaucracy deal with it? And what do we need to do to, I wouldn't use the word reform, but maybe, get the bureaucracy to actually serve the people?
We are behind. To be honest, we are behind with our colleague in Singapore and Malaysia about bureaucracy efficiency. But to be optimist, that is something that we can catch up. And now everything is very open. You can compare, like example, how long does it take to open a company in Singapore, Malaysia, and Indonesia? You can compare easily, how much how much time you need to underwrite a bond issuance, like example. How many documents are needed? So the good thing about opening up and information availability, you can easily compare. And sometimes we got, shame to ourselves that we are behind. But to be honest, we are behind. We would like to move. But again, Pak Marsudi knows in Indonesia sometimes, it takes time and consensus to move on.
Well, I have a very naughty answer to give to all you all. If you're interested in improving bureaucracy, come and study the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy. But more seriously.
About learning to be more bureaucratic.
No. The more seriously, only 20% of our students come from Singapore, and we try to get 20% Southeast Asia, 20% China, 20% India, 20% the rest of the world. So we have the most globalized classroom in the world at the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy. And the good news is that when I talk to these young people studying at our school, their awareness of the rest of the world is amazing. Their awareness of these indices, their awareness of what needs to be done, how to improve their processes, and so on and so forth. So whereas in the past, you had to struggle to find out where the best practices were in any field, now you can get it within 24 hours, And so that makes it much easier if you want to decide which directions to go in. So even though people say that it's actually very slow to change bureaucracy, and historically that's true, bureaucracies are traditionally organizations that are inert and difficult to move. But now I think you find increasingly that more and more innovation is coming actually in the bureaucratic sphere. I was going to mention Shok very quickly. I think there may be a Malaysian colleague here whom we can speak a bit about ASEAN Economic Community too.
About Mustafa.
Minister Mustafa is sitting there.
He's been very Malaysia quiet. I was wondering whether he could say a word about ASEAN Economic Community.
Can we have a mic to the minister, please?
Sorry if I spoke.
I'm supposed to be a backbencher. I'm listening to your very provocative comments. I must say, very refreshing. On the one hand, there's optimism. On the other, there are a number of roadblocks, as you rightly pointed out. And that's a challenge. We have a big wish list, and we know what we want to achieve at the end of the year. We know where we are now. Our challenge is between now, April 20th, and November 2015 to see what can be done. So there's a long, long, long way to go, but we are committed in ASEAN. We ministers, economic and other ministers, we are committed to move faster. So I think your comments have been very useful, very pertinent. I've been listening attentively, and thank you so much. I do not want to go into details. For that, we need to have a private conversation. Thank you very much. It's been very useful.
Thank you, Minister. Yeah. Any other comments? You need a mic. Can you just come forward, please?
Hello, my name is Kartika Sukarno, and I run the Kartika Sukarno Foundation. To answer to Ambassador Kishore's comment, before sending Indonesian children to the Lee Kuan Yew School, I suggest we improve the early development children's center in Posyandu's, because by the age of two, 80% of the brain cells are fully formed, and unfortunately in Indonesia still 5 million children under the age of five suffer from severe malnutrition. So the key for long-term prosperity would be to revitalize the Posyandus and to invest more in early childhood development. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments, questions? Maybe I can direct a question. Oh,
there's one guy.
There's one?
Yes.
Go ahead, please.
Hi, my name is Patrick Fay from BTS.
Could you please stand up?
Oh, sure.
We can't see you. Yes, there you go.
So there's a lot of talk about the magnificent growth in Indonesia, both as a country and also the companies within it. And I guess there's also a lot of talk about education and development. My question is, what are the things that need to be done to really develop the leaders of tomorrow? Pak Budi talked about the leaders of today and the leaders of tomorrow. So what initiatives need to be in place to really kind of proactively develop the leaders of tomorrow? And to really help support the growth that's happening both in the country and in the companies within it.
Well, I would say, as in every other country, I think with the improved education, with improved opportunities both in private and in public institutions, I think leaders will develop. Of course, you know, one can also have special schools, but I would certainly see, and we see it at BCG. You know, when we attract a lot of talent from Indonesia, I think every year there are a lot of people with great skills, with great energy and drive, and so I have no doubts that, you know, within the society of 250 million people. There are lots of potential leaders. We just have to provide them with the opportunities, and it's a responsibility of all of us to make that work, whether it's in public institutions, whether it's in private ones, and give them the responsibility and the opportunity to develop their capabilities, and also really place clearly responsibilities on their shoulders so that they can grow and grow with the challenges.
Okay, we are going to run out of time soon, but maybe the two of you can wrap it up for us.
Ladies first. Yeah.
So with that opportunities, we also need to look closely and more carefully on the fields that are really marginalized here. Mm. Like we talk about agriculture, for instance, also maritime, forestry. Those are fields that people are not really going into, although they might be trained in the field. So yes, we are training leaders, but we also need to hone them to direct them towards the field that Indonesia is in most demand in.
Let me answer your question. A strong believer that study is not, the best study is not in school, the best study is in life. Mandiri established a Mandiri University because we strongly believe people got formal education only 18 years. You work with our bank, the average is 30 years. So we have 30 years curriculum instead of 18 years curriculum. The best teachers, I'm sorry, it's not only professor. The best teachers is leaders, business leader, your bosses. If you work for a good boss, you will become a good leader. The best environment is not only classroom teachings. The best environment is really, working together with a great leaders will change you to become a different person. And the best, measurement is not score. It's not index. It's not exam. The best measurement for us, what we believe, that's why in our Mandiri University program, is how successful you are running the business and how successful you are to become a person. Mandiri
and
alumni
building, and building a team.
And building the team. Yes. Mandiri alumni, we successfully produce finance ministers. We produce also central bank governor. We produce many CEOs coming from our institutions. I think that is the best success that we can ever deliver to educate the country and promoting education for the people.
Yeah. Actually, that leader is not produced by the only universities or colleges. But in Indonesia, praise be to Allah, alhamdulillah, we have many NGOs. The leaders can study there. We have many organizations that the leaders coming from there. And also we have many parties that the leaders also coming from there. Many, many universities and colleges in Indonesia, they produce the scholarship, also they produce the leaders. And most of them, you know, we can imagine that NU from the central until the village, the board until the village. So NU also the produce many leaders from the village until the central board.
Thank you. I think we've had a very interesting, a very insightful and hopefully a provocative discussion this morning. I would like to thank my panel for joining me and for sharing with us your views and your insights. This has been Barita Satyo English at the World Economic Forum. I think the takeaway from the discussion this morning really is, you know, is how you look at things, a glass half full or a glass half empty. And in Indonesia's case, I think it's definitely half full and all the, and a lot of opportunities to fill that cup. Thank you very much. And keep watching Barita Satyo.